In this edition of Art Loft, the innovator of postmodern cartoon expressionism.
Really, it was just my parents and a few other people that were interested in what I was doing, but I was still very dedicated to it. And when I started doing work bigger and in color, it's like people just immediately started to recognize it.
And a look at the lasting influence of one of the world's most iconic pop artists.
The Warhol effect is still with us.
Life is a cabaret for these young actors. And an in-depth look at the complex characters of Downton Abbey.
They're not black or white. They're not goodies or baddies. We can see shades of grey in all of them.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft. Funding for Art Loft is made possible by
Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and this is Art Loft. This week, we come to you from the Museum of Art, Fort Lauderdale. The museum is currently featuring an exhibition called Pop Art in America, drawn from the museum's permanent collection. But our first story this week features a local artist whose work is often described as postmodern cartoon expressionism. The artist, known as Lebo, uses his cartoon imagery saturated with rich color to tell emotional narratives.
My brother and I are first-generation American. Our parents are Cuban, and they were exiled. My mom was especially exiled. So early on, our parents were really big about helping us cultivate a voice and pursuing our passion through that. And they never really told us what it is that we had to do. It was more a matter of figuring out what you wanted to do and just being really dedicated to it. So that's really, I mean, my brother's a writer and a broadcaster, and I do visual art. As I like to say, he's the words and I'm the pictures. And I think that stemmed from that, from especially my mom wanting to give us a platform to be able to express ourselves. But they also sort of let me dictate my own direction, and because they really didn't know anything about art. But I can remember when I was going to FIU for college, I was taking some fine art classes. And at the time I was studying cartooning, and there was these sable-haired brushes that were about $80 that were really, they were very expensive at the time. But it's what I wanted, but I didn't need them for school because we weren't learning that in the fine art classes. I was learning that independently. And I can remember seeing my parents in the art supply store just standing there and me getting this brush and them not questioning it. And I remember thinking about how cool that was. That, you know, we didn't have a ton of money, and it was definitely a sacrifice for us to buy those things, but they still did it with a really open heart. And there's a million stories like that of what they did in regards to supporting the dream without really even knowing what it was, and that meant the world to me. But it was really a good 10 years of dedicated service to my craft that I did happily. I mean, I spent 3 years as an assistant curator at the International Museum of Cartoon Art. I was 2 years as an intern at the Miami Herald's art department before I ever started making money at it. So that was 5 years of, you know, hundreds of hours of studying and being involved in my craft, aside from what I was doing in my house. So it was one of those things that was kind of an overnight thing, but it still took 10 years for that part to happen. The success came pretty quickly once I started painting. That was a really strange thing and a wonderful thing, because when I worked in black and white, which was my whole life growing up until 20, 21 years old, really it was just my parents and a few other people that were interested in what I was doing, but I was still very dedicated to it. And when I started doing work bigger and in color, it's like people just immediately started to recognize it. And I thought that was great, because I was graduating from FIU. I just finished getting my master's in art ed, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do. Success, I think, beyond that point, is just following some basic business tenets, which was always really being true to my word and meeting my deadlines and under-promise and over-delivering, really just trying to make people happy with what I did. And and putting everything I had into every single job that I had. And I still really have that attitude about it. I don't care if it's for free or if it's for a lot of money or for a little money. Every job I'm working on is the most important job. And that's something that I've held on to since the very beginning. My first jobs were doing big murals for construction companies and development companies. And what I realized about them is that they paid really well and they paid on time and they treated my work with a lot of respect. My experience with art galleries and things like that was kind of the opposite. They weren't as true to their word. They weren't as above board. And early on, I made a decision that I was going to go after corporate work over gallery work because I just felt like that was the more concrete work. And I felt like I wanted my art to fill in all the gaps outside of the art world. Well, thankfully, at this point, I have a nice, dedicated group of collectors and clients that support what I do and believe in what I do. So I get a lot of different commission work and sell work privately. And that's ongoing, which is a really nice thing because I worked many years to just have steady income and just have people support what it is that I do. And then beyond that, a large contract that I just received from Norwegian Cruise Line was to design their ship. A new ship of theirs called the Getaway that's going to be launched next January. So I'm actually designing the whole exterior of the ship, and the reception area is going to be used as my gallery, and it looks like I'm going to have a gallery on board. And we're really developing a nice creative partnership. It's a big canvas. It's a big skyscraper laying down sideways, basically. I'm certainly no expert on Miami's art scene, but I do think it's got a good mix of having international attention, and it's got the right amount of platform to do serious things within. But at the same time, it's still burgeoning, and it's still something that's evolving all the time. Whereas I think places like New York and LA have parts of that, but I think they're pretty established in the way that they do things. You have your large art entities that kind of control things, and then you have your up-and-comers there, but it's not like Miami, Miami is almost like everybody's an up-and-comer. Or the ones that are pretty established are still trying to identify themselves in ways that are really creative. So I kind of feel like Miami's a teenager and New York's maybe middle-aged when it comes to the art scene and things like that. And it's really cool. And I think that a lot of artists have opportunities that didn't have opportunities when I was coming up. I mean, I've had the good fortune to be in a lot of different situations and a lot of places geographically. So I've been to certain countries where the idea of making it as an artist doesn't even exist. The economics don't allow for it. Like, I've been in places like South Africa and smaller cities in Mexico and things like that. So that's one example. You're not going to have any of that. And then other places like Chicago, New York, and LA that have these established scenes, and Paris and Barcelona. And that's kind of the other part of the spectrum where there just seems to be art everywhere. And I think Miami is becoming more and more like that. I mean, growing up, Miami always had the reputation of being what's called a chameleon city, where it was always imitating other cities and it was always kind of borrowing from other cities. And I've noticed in the last 5 or 10 years that other cities are imitating Miami now. And I think on the broader level, on the collectively conscious level, that Miami is really sort of identifying itself. And that's through the arts, and a lot of it is through other people coming here and seeing what's going on and taking a little bit back with them and sort of spreading that word that way. I think things in the visual arts like Art Basel help a lot. I think Winter Music Conference helps. I think a lot of the larger international art things help, but I think it also helps that there's art stuff going on throughout the year now, and that people are coming here to start art careers, and people do want to be here.
You can learn more about Lebo by visiting his website at lebostudios.com. And now, here's a look at some of the arts events happening this week in our community. Among the artists in the Pop Art in America collection is, of course, Andy Warhol. The Museum of Art Fort Lauderdale just recently housed an exhibition called Warhol and Cars, which looked at Warhol's fascination with automobiles as products of American consumer society. In his own time, Warhol pushed the boundaries of what defined art, challenging expectations with his portrayals of popular culture. In the exhibition Regarding Warhol, 60 Artists, 50 Years at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City, the works of Warhol are for the first time shown alongside the artists that reinterpret, respond, and react to Warhol's groundbreaking work.
The exhibition is meant to be a look at Warhol and his impact on contemporary art of the last 50 years. Warhol was willing to embrace anything, and that's the Warhol effect.
Well, it's a very large show, so there are 157 works total, and 51 of those are by Warhol.
In each grouping of works, there'll be a Warhol, or maybe two Warhols, and a group of works by other artists. Each grouping is meant to introduce other approaches to what Warhol set out.
The first section is a very large section called Daily News, From Banality to Disaster. He was constantly looking at the current news, to the newspaper, to magazines.
Warhol's sources were so often the most banal of subjects. But also from the Daily News, he took disasters. And he would make paintings based on that.
So then that section moves into an area that has to do with American consumerism, with logos, and how other artists like Ai Weiwei have appropriated those images.
For me, one of the exciting things about the show is to see Warhol juxtaposed with, for example, an artist named Hans Hacke. And he carries the Warhol example into very political dimensions. So here he's using the look of packaging, like Warhol's soup can, to then make a political statement about where cigarettes are made and this Senator Jesse Helms. There's lots of surprises like that, where artists can carry the Warhol example.
Another very large section is the portraiture section. We call it Celebrity in Power. For me, the 1964 turquoise Marilyn is such an iconic image and is so beautiful to begin with. It's absolutely electric in terms of its turquoise coloration. I love the fact that Marilyn said that Marilyn was the veil that she wore over Norma Jean. And I think that Warhol really sort of understood that there was some other human being beneath all of this blonde hair and color.
In 1960, in New York, there were almost no people making portraits. We have Warhol's Diamond Dust portrait of Joseph Beuys to exemplify Warhol celebrating artists. So behind me is a famous portrait by Chuck Close of the musician Phil Glass. There's also a photograph Richard Avedon made of Truman Capote. There's a painting by Alex Katz of the poet Ted Bergen. So this gives you a sense of how, with Warhol as an example, things expand out and become very exciting.
There's another section called Queer Studies, which is really about assumed personalities, the idea that identity, especially sexual identity, is something that can be altered, can be used in a kind of fluid and shifting and changing way. And then the last sections are really more about Warholian techniques. There's a section called Consuming Images about abstraction, seriality, and repetition. And it begins with a wonderful image of the Mona Lisa. So the rest of the gallery is in part about how other artists have absorbed this appropriation technique. And then there is a section called No Boundaries, and it really has to do with this wonderful kind of explosion of the whole Warholian phenomenon and the idea that art really can be anything.
One of the interesting things about doing this exhibition was to think about how alive the legacy is right now. Ryan Tricarton is a filmmaker. If you compare them to the Andy Warhol films, you quickly realize that Ryan Tricarton is a descendant of Andy Warhol. A show of his work opened a little over a year ago and was met by unbelievable praise. If a contemporary artist is still moved by Andy Warhol, and that artist happens to be so celebrated, then the Warhol effect is still with us.
Our idea about the exhibition was not simply an idea of direct influence, but the impact through the culture of Warhol, but also not with the idea that this is the definitive show. It should get people talking. I would hope that people think about where Warhol's impact goes beyond the galleries and to have a kind of heightened awareness when they next go to galleries or to a department store or flip through a magazine or surf the web, and how Warhol will seem very ever-present. I'll be your
mirror. After Andy Warhol's unexpected death in 1987, a foundation was set up in his name to advance the visual arts. For more information, visit warholfoundation.org. The New World School of the Arts has a long history of taking in high school and college students and turning out artists, musicians, and most notably, young actors, supplying South Florida's theater community with fresh and talented faces.
My name is Patrice Bailey, and I am the Dean of Theater here at New World School of the Arts. New World School of the Arts is a magnet arts program for high school students, and we also offer a four-year college degree for visual arts, for dance, for music, and theater. Thrilled to be directing Cabaret, and this is actually our third production that we've done with the college, and it was one of our first productions when the school first opened. This production involves our sophomore, junior, and senior music theater students and some acting students, and I'm very delighted that this year we have an acting student that got the lead, the male lead in Cabaret, which is a little unusual for us.
My name is Stella Brankovic, and I'm the costumer at New World School of the Arts in the theater department. We have a wardrobe manager or two wardrobe managers that deal with the show in the shop, and then they run the show backstage. And we do it like in the real world. I actually read the script, and I do my research, and then I have ideas about it, and then I discuss it with the director or with the design team, and then basically we look at what we have. We have been able to gather an immense amount of stuff in here, as you can see.
One of the goals of the college program is to produce working actors. And we've always approached this by telling our students that one day we hope that we are collaborating with them and that they are becoming our colleagues. And I'm very proud of our graduates. In the last 3 years, our students have performed in over 100 productions, both here on Miami stages as well as national commercials and on Broadway. So it's very rare that you will go to a show here in Miami and not see a New World student. Recently, we had 3 students in the production of Hamlet at Gable Stage, directed by an alumni, Terrell McCraney, also starring a faculty member, James Randolph, playing Claudius, and an alumni, Alina Arenas, who was playing a Gertrude. So to give the students the opportunity to work at Gable Stage with professional actors really enhances the training, so then when they get out of here, they have it on their resume, and they have the experience, professional experience that they wouldn't get ordinarily. So we really look for opportunities for the students, whether it's at City Theater, it's at Zoetic Theater, especially in their senior year, to give them an opportunity to start working within the community.
The current production of Cabaret runs through February 17th, and if you'd like more information, visit nwsa.mdc.edu. And now, here's a look back at what happened this week in arts history. Fans of the hit series Downton Abbey might think they know all of the characters as if they were real, but in her new official companion book to the series, The Chronicles of Downton Abbey, author Jessica Fellows takes readers even further into the story, highlighting the characters and the behind-the-scenes drama as Downton Abbey enters the 1920s. Here's a look.
The Chronicles of Downton Abbey is the official tie-in companion book for the television series Downton Abbey, and it's the second book that we've done with this
with the show. And this one is very character-led, so each chapter is headed up by one or two characters. And we took a triple-layered approach to it. So there's a look at the show itself, the series as if it was a live and present thing, which is how it feels when it comes into our TVs on Sunday night. And then we look at how the production kind of brought all that together. So Julian's scripts, the actors and what they think about their own backstories, the art department, hair and costume and all the, you know, props and all the rest of it. And then the third layer is the social history, so the context in which everything is set, which demonstrates the authenticity of the show. I mean, what is quite interesting is that I think there's quite a different atmosphere on the set. So Highclere Castle, which is the setting for the house and all the above stairs scenes. I mean, it is a real working house, you know, it's been sitting there like that for the last 400, 500 years or whatever, and there is that real sense of its presence as you arrive, and I think it makes all the actors, I mean, I can feel myself sitting up straighter just talking about it, you know, you kind of have to have that presence in a room, and you talk in a different kind of a way, and you have to have respect for the house. There's a lot of valuables there. I mean, the art department don't put very much in there apart from a few potted palms. I mean, all those things like costumes, they really help, and that's partly why it's so important that everything is authentic in the way that it is. It's not just that it looks right for us, but it helps the actors to sit properly. I mean, the starched collars, particularly for the men, I gather, are horrible, kind of rubbing their necks quite raw. The women obviously have the corsets. They've begun to get a little bit easier now for the third season. They're not quite as constricting, and sort of they have this sort of S-bend shape almost. In the first season, so now it's more about flattening the figure out. Nevertheless, they all have to wear them and live with that. But that does make them sit in the right way and walk in the right way. I mean, and I think also they've picked it up as they go. I mean, Rob Collier, who plays Thomas, says that he doesn't really like watching scenes from the first season because he thinks he was walking the wrong way. Because they learn you're not supposed to put your hands in your pockets and having to sit up and, you know, sit down and stand up. I know they had to reshoot a scene when the historical advisor was away that day, and Matthew Crawley didn't stand up when the Dowager Countess came into the room. They said there was just absolutely no way that could ever have happened. You couldn't possibly air a scene like that, so they had to redo it. Julian said he always begins with the fundamental belief that everybody is good. They start good and then something may take them off that path along the way. And I think that's what's really interesting about all of the characters is they're not black or white. They're not goodies or baddies. We can see shades of grey in all of them. I mean, even O'Brien, who's probably the most evil schemer of all, and even Julian would admit that. There are still times when you see her and you think, some soft spots in that heart, you know. Now we would probably call her damaged and send her to therapy and things, you know, but then she just had to live her way through it. But I always get asked, what's my favourite character? And it's slightly like selecting your children out, you know, because I've got to know them all so well now. I feel like I've seen them develop over three seasons and talk to the actors and talk to the production and, you know, all these sort of details that I know about them. That I kind of love them all in their own special way.
I have great news for fans of Downton Abbey. Even though season 3 concludes this Sunday, you have a chance to meet Jessica Fellows in person and support WPBT2 at the same time. For details on how to attend a dinner with Miss Fellows, please visit WPBT2's website at wpbt2.org/Downton. That wraps it up for this edition of Art Loft. We'd like to thank the Museum of Art Fort Lauderdale for allowing us to spend some time in their exhibitions. And for more about the museum's schedule, you can visit moafl.org. And for more information about the arts and culture, visit wpbt.org, where you'll find feature videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. Until next time, stay creative. I'm Kaylin James, and thanks for watching Art Loft. Funding for Art Loft was made possible by
Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation.